take me on the journey of letting go, get lost in you. My heart is open. Receive your light. You give me faith like a child. In you my heart runs wild. Cause there's no shame looking like a fool when I give you what I can't keep. Take a hold. More than words, more than good idea, I found your love in the open field. More than words, more than good idea, I found your love in the open field. More than words, more than I found your love in the open fields. But more than words, more than good ideas, I found your love in the open fields. From the head to the heart, take me on the journey. Take me on the journey of letting go, get lost in you.
Amen. Amen. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to the Cobb Vineyard this morning. We're so glad that you've come here to join us. We'd like to invite you to come on in. If you're out in the lobby wandering around, come on in and find a seat. And we're going to worship here in just a minute. If you're joining us here on Facebook Live this morning, we're glad you're here. We're glad you're joining us, whether you're in your living room or bedroom or in the coffee shop somewhere or the hospital or the beach or wherever you might happen to be. We just invite you to just worship with us in whatever way is natural and authentic for you. So I'm going to pray, and then we'll lift our voices in worship. Father, we just welcome you this morning. We're so grateful that we know that when we gather to meet with you, that you are here to meet with us. So Father, we just pray that you would enable us to worship you in spirit and truth this morning. Father, however we're feeling, if we're just feeling happy and joyful and we love the morning, or if we're just dragging in a little bit, Father, we're feeling in a low place. Father, I pray that you would just be with us, minister to us in your faithfulness, and just enable us to lift our voices to you. Amen. Amen. We'll just invite you, if you can, stand where you're sitting, and let's worship the Lord together. Amen. And I count on one thing, the same God that never fails. He will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. And yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify of all names, that nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. And yes, I will bless your name. I'll bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Oh yes, I will, yes, I will. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will. I will lift your name on high. We'll praise you, Lord.
search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Mountains of praise, treasures of faith were never denied. You came along, put me back together. Now every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing that's better than you, no, there's nothing that's better. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountains, the God of the valley, there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing that's better.
Nothing is better than you.
is nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you.
Jesus, you do turn our mourning into dancing. And you turn our shame into glory. Father, you do those things through the work that you did on the cross when you took our sin upon yourself. Jesus, you didn't have to do it, Father. You had no sin to pay for of your own, but you took our sins upon you. And we're just so grateful we come before you in humility and gratitude this morning for what you've done. Going to take some time this morning to take communion together. And as many of you know, the way we do that is we have cups that are up here on these front two tables. So I just invite you to come and get one of those if you don't have one already. Bring it back to your seat. We're all going to take it together. The cup has a juice in the bottom, and then it has bread. I think it's bread. I've been told it's bread in the top. It's a takes a little talent to peel these back in the right order, but if you practice a little bit, you'll get it. So Father, we're just so grateful for the work that you've done, Lord, for the sacrifice that you paid, for the work that you did on the cross. Father, we know that we are not worthy to come before you, but because of the work that you've done, you've made us worthy. You've paid the ultimate sacrifice, and we're so grateful for your broken body. We celebrate that this morning. We remember that this morning. So let's take the bread together. And Jesus, we remember also the blood that you spilled. Father, we know that our forgiveness came at a price, and you paid that price for us. You paid that price so that we can stand before you blameless and worthy today. And we're so grateful for that. So let's take the cup together. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Amen. We're going to continue in worship now. So we invite you again, if you're able, to just stand where you are as we sing about the wonderful, merciful Savior.
Redeemer and friend, who would have thought? falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore.
Yes, you are.
You give the healing and grace. Our hearts always
amazing love that welcomes me, the kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving. And God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Behold the cross.
Should this life bring suffering, Lord, I will remember what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever. God, you're so good. Thank you for your goodness. Father, thank you that we know that despite all of our imperfections, Father, you are perfect. And Father, you're making us more like you every day. Father, we rejoice in that. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Celebrate and remember the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. And so it's an awesome, fantastic day. I think Joel is coming to tell me that something's not working.
Can
you hear me?
I'll yell louder.
No, I've got some good news and some bad news. The good news is we're all ready for the microphones for Easter because we have a special presentation. The bad news is we used your channel for that and didn't know it. Until now. So here's your mic.
Thank you. Hey, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. No, I'm just kidding. Thanks, Joel. That's right. Awesome. Good Friday. This coming Friday is Good Friday. And so what we want to do on Friday evening from 7 to 8 is to join together in this room and really focus in and remember the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. The purpose and the focus this coming Friday is going to be all about the cross. It's going to be about what God did for us and in us as a result of the cross. Romans 5 tells us that we are now reconciled to God by the death of his son. And we're gonna be talking about what does that mean to be reconciled to God? What does that mean? What's the import of that in our lives? And we're gonna hone in on that and focus in on that and celebrate the incredible gift that God has given us. So that's this Friday, 7 o'clock, plan to be here. It's gonna be an awesome time. The second thing, next Sunday is Easter. Easter is about the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. And so we're going to come together and we are going to celebrate the incredible resurrection of Jesus. That same scripture in Romans 5 says this, now we have been reconciled to God by the death of his son. How much more shall we be saved through his very resurrected life? And so we're going to talk about this salvation that God has wrought within us and is offering to us through the resurrection of Jesus and the power of his life lived out in us. And so it's going to be a fantastic weekend. I hope you're planning on being here. Bring a friend with you. It's going to be, like I say, just a great, great time of celebration. You know, sometimes like in our culture, we kind of get caught up and, you know, we think Christmas is like the most Christian thing. Let me tell you, I praise God for Christmas. Without Christmas, the rest of it doesn't happen. But I'm telling you, the most significant event in the history of the world is the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's nothing. There's nothing even close. And so we're going to be coming together over the course of this coming weekend and celebrating this incredible, incredible, incredible event that is transforming our lives. And so I hope that you're planning on being here, being a part, and we would love to see you as much as possible. Now, this Sunday, today, is what on the Christian calendar is called Palm Sunday. And just to sort of set a context, I wanted to read the story. So if you have your Bibles, we're actually going to be looking at two passages, but the first one is found in Luke chapter 19, if you want to turn there. Luke chapter 19. It starts off, Luke 19 is telling the story of Jesus approaching Jerusalem. He's coming up through Bethsaida and Bethphage and coming over the Mount of Olives. And as he is beginning that approach, he has sent a couple of disciples in and, you know, is saying, you know, the master needs a colt. And so they've gotten the colt and brought it to him. And so in verse 35, it says, they brought it to Jesus and they threw their cloaks on the colt and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. And so it was the way of honoring a conquering hero that was approaching a town. As a war had taken place, they would make the road lined with their coats. And so that's what they were doing. They were honoring this coming king coming in. Mark 11:8 says this, kind of adds this to it. It says, many people spread their cloaks on the road while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. They had cut palm branches, which is where we get the idea of palm branches and Palm Sunday. And so it's this celebration of Jesus as he's triumphantly riding into Jerusalem. He peeks over, if you've never been there, the Mount of Olives sits, Bethsaida's just on the backside. It peeks over, and there's a road that winds down, goes right by the Garden of Gethsemane, across the Kidron Valley into the city of Jerusalem. And so Jesus came off of this hill wandering through. And as he did, people just begin to line up. I mean, it almost, in my mind, it kind of gives the idea of everybody coming out of the city. The king is coming, and there's just this incredible celebration. It's like the Macy's Day Parade
times 14 billion, you know, as people are just lining the roads and screaming and shouting and so excited. The king is coming. This is something they've been anticipating, looking forward to. They've been taught about this in their Sabbath day classes and talked about the Messiah coming. And there was this anticipation of this coming Messiah. And it says, when he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Just think about these residents of Jerusalem that had been witness to so many of the miracles of Jesus, so many of the movements of God and the incredible, just the incredible things. Like I say, where Lazarus had been risen from the dead was only probably a mile from here. It was just a very short distance. Remember the one that was laying by the pool of Bethesda that Jesus had come in and had raised him up and healed him over and over and over again. So many of the miracles that are recorded. And then John tells us that books couldn't contain all the things that Jesus had done. That if everything he had done and said was written down, that all the libraries in the entire world couldn't even hold it. You know, I mean, he was obviously speaking in hyperbole, but there was that sense to where that there was just multitude of things. And in this moment, it culminates and everybody is coming out and there's this moment of incredible celebration and exaltation as the king is coming into Jerusalem, as the king is riding in. And there's the anticipation. This is the moment. This is the moment for it all to come together, and the exaltation of the king and the coronation of the king is all going to happen, and everybody is there and everybody's a part of it and everybody is cheering and everybody is screaming their heads off. And it says the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. He said, blessed is the king who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And so there's this incredible, incredible, incredible celebration, this incredible, can you just imagine the energy of the crowd? I mean, just the energy of the moment. You would just, I'm sure everybody's just kind of sucked into it emotionally and physically as all of this moment seems to culminate right here, right now. And I think about that scene, and I think, where were these people a few days later? Where were these people? I know some of them were probably in the crowd yelling, "Crucify him!" Many of them had just gone back home. Many of them had probably just picked up life and moved on because there was this incredible event that happened, but that was last week. You know, and now we've kind of moved on. And, you know, as I read this story, as I think about Palm Sunday, not so much historically, but in the parallels in our own world, in our own life, so often we have a tendency to be sucked into the exciting, to be sucked into to the moment. We get very caught up in the moment. We get enthralled in the moment. But then it just, a lot of times it doesn't affect us. It doesn't impact us. It doesn't transform us. It changes. It doesn't lead anywhere. It's an event. It's something that just sort of happens, but then we go back and just kind of do. And I'm afraid too often that that's a picture of the way that we tend to do church. It's a picture of the way that we tend to almost see our relationship with God a lot of times. There's this sense of being drawn into the moment, and there's a celebration, and there's excitement, and there's all this joy and all that kind of stuff. But for whatever reason, come Wednesday and Thursday and Friday, it doesn't seem to have the same impact in our lives. We forget the very thing we talk in here a lot of times, that Christianity is a lot about left foot, right foot, left foot, right foot. It's about this continuity. It's about this continuousness. It's not running from high moment to high moment to high moment. There's really, you know, we have to transform our thoughts and our minds. That, you know, I praise God for those high moments. I praise God for the energy and the celebration and the exaltation and those kinds of moments that are just wonderful and fantastic. But those are not the things that life is made of. That's not what life is made of. Life is really all about Tuesdays and Thursdays, with the anticipation and the hope that Sunday's coming. But it's, how are we going to live today? How are we going to walk? I think about that specifically in the arena of the local church. You know, so often, you know, we especially in the charismatic world, we tend to think of church as like going from conference to conference to conference. We're looking for high point, high point, high point, rather than understanding that so much of the local church is about left foot, right foot, left foot, right foot. It's about, hey, I know that your kid is sick in the hospital and you're struggling. Can we come alongside you and provide a meal for you? Can we undergird you? Can we somehow or another connect together? I know that you're struggling in this area. Can we come alongside and help? I know that, hey, I just want you to know that God is using you. Last night we were sitting, and I'm going to talk, a couple of things happened last night, but last night we were talking in our small group, and one of them's family member had interactions with one of the other people in the group, and they just began to tell them, wow, I just want you to know what an impact you had on my sister. And they begin to tell them about the words of life that had been spoken. And I was just watching this transfer. And the person that they're been talking about, it's just like a load is being lifted off because a word of encouragement is being spoken. It's like, that's what the local church is about. It's about that opportunity to come alongside and to connect together. And like I say, praise God for the high moments. Praise God for the exaltation. Praise God for all of that stuff. But God, teach us to walk left foot, right foot. Teach us to understand how to come alongside one another. Teach us how to connect with and undergird. And it's really interesting in Acts chapter 18, which is where we're headed. We've been doing this series through the book of Acts. The section that we come to today is such a contrast, I think, in so many ways to the way that we tend to think of things. So if you have your Bible, turn over to Acts chapter 18. And we'll be actually starting in verse 18. And when I thought about what does this section of Scripture talk to us about, I think that it communicates to us the strength of many. The strength of many. That what we're going to see in this passage of Scripture is the body of Christ at work. How people connect with and walk with one another. Acts chapter 18, verse 18, it says this. Let me tell you this. I want to go through this relatively quickly because I believe, you know how it says, what we just read, it said that everybody was praising God for the wonders and the miracles they had seen. I believe that God wants to show up this morning and do miracles. I believe that God wants to show up and touch people physically and bring healing. I believe that God wants to reach into situations and bring about the very life of God in those things. And so when we get done and you say, wow, that wasn't as long as he normally talks, don't get so excited. We believe God's going to show up and do something. Get excited about that, okay? So anyway, Acts 18, 18 says this. Paul stayed on in Corinth for some time. Actually, he stayed roughly for about 18 months. It says, then he left the brothers and sisters, and he sailed for Syria, which means that he was heading back towards Antioch. He was trying to get to Antioch, which is where Syria is. But he was accompanied by Priscilla and Aquila. And remember, we had talked about Priscilla and Aquila. They were tent makers. They had come from Rome. They had moved to Corinth. And there Paul had struck up a relationship with them. And they wound up working together as tent makers and did this. But also Paul was influencing them for the kingdom. And so they became friends. And you'll notice they appear several times through the scriptures in Corinthians and in Romans as Paul is talking about their service in the kingdom. But here we see when they go to leave Corinth that Priscilla and Aquila travel with Paul. It says, before he sailed, he had his hair cut off at Cenchreae because of a vow he had taken. Man, you would not believe the theologians that have such a problem with this passage of Scripture. I was amazed at people that were saying, oh, well, Paul obviously had not gotten completely free. God had not completely set him free from his Jewishness yet, because he was still living in the midst of this, making vows and stuff. And, you know, as a Christian, he shouldn't have done that. But you know, it was still just ingrained in him from his upbringing. And I just was reading that thinking, that is, I think, some of the weirdest stuff I've ever read. That was just weird to me. Because when what I understand Paul to be doing here is that Paul was in a place where he wanted to, with devotion and focus, make a move forward in God. And as a result of that, he had said, you know what, I want to take these next 30 days, because that's the vow that he had taken. I want to take these next 30 days, and I want to use them and devote myself. And so he took what is called a Nazarite vow, and there's many parts to it, but one of the things that you do is you shave off your head completely and totally, and then for 30 days, you know, it grows back, and at the end of the 30 days, you shave off what has grown back, and you offer that as a burnt offering, because it's a symbol of the 30 days that you've set aside for the Lord. It includes no alcohol, crossing your lips, which means that Paul couldn't have taken communion during those 30 days. But it really is an opportunity that he took to say, you know what, God, I want to move forward in my relationship with you. I want to take a step. I want something to happen. And as a result, I'm going to set aside this time, and I'm going to commit myself to doing this. It's the very same thing that we'll do sometimes when you say, you know what, I'm going to fast for the next week, and I'm going to pray through this particular situation. It's that kind of a mindset. And so acts of dedication and focus are a great thing. It's a great thing to take a step in God, to say, you know what, God, I want to take these next 30 days. I want to take these next 2 weeks. I want to take these, whatever it is. I'm not going to eat, because right now this is more important than eating. I'm not going to do this. Whatever it is, setting aside that time for an opportunity that says, I want to move forward in God. I want to focus in. I want to be devoted to this. I want to step this out. That's what I believe that Paul was saying. Now, acts or vows or things like that try to manipulate God, that says, okay, God, I'm going to do this for 10 days, and at the end of that, you need to. That's not biblical. That's not the way we approach things, okay? Our God is in the heavens. He does whatever he pleases, okay? So we have to remember that. We don't manipulate God. We don't push the right button and he jumps out through the hoop. It does not work that way. But we can humble ourselves before him, and we can commit ourselves and devote ourselves and say, God, I want to make this part of, give you an idea. Last night while we were at our small group, one thing that I believe that God has been stirring within me, and I believe that it's bigger than me and here, and I believe it really is a season that our country is in, and maybe the entire world. But I believe that there is an openness and a rising hunger for the reality of God and of who he is. I think coming out of the pandemic, that there is a renewed awakening that is taking place in our world. And we just talked about how that so often, too often, Christians are disconnected from the very people that really need God. The reality is that when somebody first gets saved, for about the first 5 years of their life, they're like insane and want to drag everybody that they know into a relationship with Jesus. And people always say, wow, he's quite an evangelist. Have you seen that? He's led 5 people to the Lord over these last few years. That's phenomenal what's happening. But the reality is, the reason he's led 5 people to the Lord is because he knows 5 people that don't know Jesus, and he's talked to them about it. The problem is what happens over the course of time is we tend to gravitate towards one another, and there's lots of legitimate reasons for that, and we get in these relationships, and we begin to live in what I always have called the Christian ghetto. We live in this area where everybody around us is exactly the same. We see things the same. We view life the same. And what happens as a result of that is that we no longer have the relationships with people outside the church that are lost and apart from God, and to be able to influence them towards Him. And the reality is, I know many of you are sitting here looking at me saying, well, that's not true of me, you know. And I would say that may not be true of you, but if you look around the room, it's true of about 85% of the other people sitting in here. Okay, so as we talked about that, I said, you know, I challenge us to take the next 30 days and to really ask God to say, God, over these next 30 days, I want to pray for one or two or maybe three specific names, specific people that I know don't know You. And every day, I want to commit myself to praying daily for this person by name. God, I want You to set up divine appointments. I want You to send somebody that will tell them the good news, that will show them the good news, that will be good news to them and help them to come to understand the greatness of who You are. And so we talked about that as a group and spent some time kind of working through what that means. I would encourage every one of us in this room to do that. I believe that we're in a season that we're going to see more and more people come to faith in Christ because there's an openness to spirituality and an openness to who God is. And so begin to pray and ask God to open up the windows of heaven and pour out His Spirit and send out His army that people will be impacted and influenced for His kingdom. Amen. So, amen. So before he sailed, he had his hair cut off at Cenchreae because of a vow he had taken. They arrived at Ephesus, where Paul left Priscilla and Aquila. He himself went into the synagogue and reasoned with the Jews. And so they get there. I don't know if Priscilla and Aquila were checking into the hotel, what was going on. Paul goes over to the synagogue and begins to reason with the Jews. When they asked him to spend some more time with them, he declined. But as he left, he promised, I will come back if it's God's will. Then he set sail from Ephesus. And then it says this, when he landed in Caesarea, he went up to Jerusalem, greeted the church, then went down to Antioch. After spending some time in Antioch, Paul set out from there and traveled from place to place through the region of Galatia and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. Now, Luke just sort of throws all this out, two or three sentences. This is what was going on. You have to understand, this is 1,500 miles of journey, okay, that Paul is involved with here. When he gets to Caesarea, goes down to Jerusalem, out to Antioch, then up to Galatia, Phrygia, that is the beginning of his third missionary journey. So Luke is just sort of putting this all in a pot and just saying, yep, this is going on. He'll come back and kind of break out and talk some about what happens beyond that. But it's interesting to me because for just a few moments, Luke totally transforms the book of Acts. Because as you look through the book of Acts, you kind of get the feeling that at the beginning of it, everything that God was doing was being done through Peter. Peter was the star. Every story seemed to indicate and sort of encircle Peter in some way or another. And then Paul comes on the scene. And all of a sudden, it's all about Paul. And Paul, this is what Paul's doing. This is where Paul's traveling. These are his companions. And it's all about Paul. And you get the idea that everything that God is doing in the entire universe is centered right here in these stories. But can I tell you something? That is not true. God was actively at work in so many other areas. God was active. All these churches that Paul would plant and then he would leave and go somewhere else. You know what? That church did not just become a bunch of mannequins frozen in place until Paul got back. That's not what happened. God continued to work. God continued to do stuff. Things were happening that Luke just didn't write about, but God was actively at work all over the place, just like He is today. God is actively at work all over the place. We tend to think and see everything in relation to what's happening around us. We say, this is what God is doing in the world because that's what God is doing in me, or that's what God is doing in our church. That's, we tend to think very myopically, I mean, very, very small. Let me ask you something. Other than the Trepaniers and the Browns, I would say probably everybody else in this room passed at least one other church on their way here this morning. Is that true? Like I say, the Trepaniers live about three doors up, so they may not have. Browns live right across the street. They may not have. But pretty much everybody else passed at least one, probably closer to 15 churches on their way here, okay? And we have a tendency to think in terms of, well, this is what God is doing. But can I tell you something? Every one of those places you passed by, every one of them, God is actively at work in. Every single one. I would encourage you. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you chose to be here. Hope you plan to be here next week too, okay? And moving forward and all that kind of stuff. But I would encourage you, while you're driving in, when you pass a church, pray for that church. Because God is actively at work in that place. He said, Jesus said, where two or three will gather together in my name, I'm going to be there. That's what he said. That's what he said. And so I encourage you to understand that God is bigger than what you see. God is bigger. Because when you understand that God is alive and active and on the move and working, and a lot of it is in ways that I don't understand and I don't connect with and doesn't mean a whole lot to me, but you know what? It means a whole lot to them. And I praise God for that. I praise God for every person whose heart gets stirred towards him in any way that moves them from where they are towards a love and affectionate relationship with Jesus. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. We're so thankful for our brothers and sisters that look differently and walk differently than we are, than we do. I'm thankful for that. I'm not intimidated by that. I don't say they're right, we're wrong, or we're right, they're wrong. It's just different. And Luke illustrates that here. In verse 24, he says, meanwhile, back at the ranch, a Jew named Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. Now, Alexandria is really became a major training center for the church in the centuries that progressed on. Alexandria is in Egypt. It's on the coast of the Mediterranean, but kind of on the southern area. Apollos, a native of Alexandria, came to Ephesus. It says he was a learned man with a thorough knowledge of the scriptures. He had been instructed in the way of the Lord. And he spoke with great fervor and taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. Now, Luke, for whatever reason, does not tell us why this is true. I've got some ideas. I mean, my thoughts are maybe Apollos was a disciple of John's and had been traveling with John or staying with John and learning from John, had been there perhaps when Jesus came to get baptized and heard John say, behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He'd been taught about the Messiah and been aware of that. And then when John was arrested and beheaded, maybe he went back home to Alexandria, and so he didn't further his understanding. That's one possibility. Or a disciple of John's came to Alexandria and told Apollos about it. I don't know, but for some reason, Apollos only he understood about the Messiah. He was accurate about that. He understood about Jesus. Was accurate about that, but his accuracy only went so far. It says he had been instructed in the way of the Lord. He spoke with great fervor, taught about Jesus accurately, though he knew only the baptism of John. So he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. So he'd show up in the synagogue, and it'd be his turn to preach, and he would talk, and he would communicate about the testimony of Jesus and the Messiah that was to come. And it says he did it passionately and strongly and accurately. But it said one particular Saturday, as they're all sitting there, it says when Priscilla and Aquila heard him, they invited him to their home and explained to him the way of God more adequately. The word literally means exactly, accurately, perfectly. They filled in all the missing parts. Now, the reason that I bring up this story, and especially what I was talking about early, is I love this. Priscilla and Aquila are sitting there in their church just like you're sitting here this morning. And some crazy person gets up there full of energy and full of passion, but what he's saying isn't the full story. And the question then is, how do you handle that? How do you move forward with that? What do Priscilla and Aquila do about that? Well, there's lots of different options. One, he's talking publicly, and so you could stand up and say, wait a minute, that's wrong. You shouldn't talk about this. This is the true thing. They did not choose that route. They went to him and they said, hey, Apollos, do you have lunch plans? We're having ham sandwich. No, they didn't say that. Okay. But they said, you know, come on over, just trying to make sure you're still awake with me. Why don't you come over to our house? And so they invited him over to the house. And as he got there, in a private setting, they began to talk to him. They began to say, wow, you know, we see that you have so much zeal. There's and so much wisdom. You understand the scriptures. You understand about the Messiah. But somehow or another, you left off the story before it ended. Let's fill in the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey would tell us. And they begin to talk to him. And I see this as such a step of loving discipleship, where they just put their arm around him and they say, hey, let's help you out here. They weren't trying to demonstrate for everybody else to see how much they knew. Listen, we've been with Paul ourselves. He lived in our house. If anybody knows, we know, we'll set you straight. It wasn't any of that. It was, hey, my friend, let's just help you learn the rest of the story. I love the honor that they showed to Apollos. I love the care and the nurture and the maturity that they showed. Remember, these guys are probably not 2 years old as far as their relationship with the Lord. And yet, they were able to step in and help this young man. So, first thing I see in this is Priscilla and Aquila doing loving discipleship. But I tell you what I see in Apollos is teachableness. 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 I'm telling you, I don't know that there is any character quality that is more important and significant, especially for a seasoned follower of Jesus, than teachableness. Than the understanding, perception, and reality that I have not arrived yet. We get thinking sometimes when we talk about the scriptures and somebody that really knows the scriptures, that what happens is that you learn the scriptures and then you spend the rest of your life kind of distributing that information and trying to implement it, but that you understand. Can I tell you, I don't believe that that's true. I mean, I listen to people preach on a really, really regular basis. And I'm not just learning, I'm not just listening so that I can get some good ideas of what to do next, okay? I'm really listening because I want to learn. I want God to transform me. I think about Paul in Philippians, you know, when he says, not that I've already obtained all this or already have been made perfect. Now, this is the guy that's wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Not that I've already been made perfect, but I strive and I move on towards the high calling, that I may know him, that I may be transformed, that I may be changed. There was a yearning in his heart that said, I need to grow. I need to be changed. I don't know it all. I'm learning. I'm in process. One thing that you see in the scriptures and one thing that you see in people's lives around you is this understanding that we are all in process. We are all in process. In fact, turn to somebody sitting next to you and say, you're in process. We're all in process. We're all being transformed. We're all in this. Now that should be really great news to you and me. Because if this is the best it gets, we're all in trouble. Okay? We are in process. God is transforming us. He's changing us. He's moving us forward. We're not there yet. There's more. There's more. And Apollos understood that. Even though he's up in front teaching, all that kind of stuff, when a loving couple comes alongside of him, he says, help me understand. And that's exactly what they did. Let me finish this real quick. Because, let me say this, because I just see it in my notes. What that indicates, you know, there's a saying in the Vineyard that says we all get to play. Everybody gets to play. And what that means is that ministry is not done from the stage. Ministry is what everybody is involved in. Okay? It's what you're called to do. It's what you're called to walk out the ministry of Jesus, whatever that looks like, whatever that means in your world, that we are, people say, are you called to the ministry? I say to you, yes, you are. If you are a follower of Jesus, you're called to ministry. That's what it means. If you follow Jesus, Jesus is always doing ministry. That's what he's doing. And so following him means you're tagging right along. You're in it. Okay? So we're all called to be a part of this. And it's not a few people do things and everybody else watches. That's not the way the church was ever designed. But it's not only that everybody gets to play. We have to understand we need everybody to play. We need everybody to play. We need everybody to play. You know, if we're sitting at a Braves game and all of a sudden you look up and the center fielder is missing, and they say, oh, well, he needed a bathroom break, so he's in the bathroom. Everybody's okay with that, right? Aren't we all, we're okay without having a center fielder, right? I mean, what can it hurt? Just for a little while, he can just sit out, right? No, we need him out there. We need him out there. If he's not out there, bad things are going to happen. Can I tell you the same thing's true in the church? May not be as upfront, may not be on TV, but there's a hole where the ministry of Jesus doesn't go forward because the person that's called to step into that role isn't there. I challenge you. We need everybody to play. Verse 27 says this. When Apollos wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers and sisters encouraged him. This Achaia is back where Corinth is, and he's heading back in that direction. When Apollos wanted to go to Achaia, the brothers and sisters encouraged him and wrote to the disciples there to welcome him. When he arrived, he was a great help to those who by grace had believed, for he vigorously refuted his Jewish opponents in public debate, proving from the scriptures that Jesus was the Messiah. So he takes the information that Priscilla and Aquila have instilled in him, and God blesses it and uses it for his glory. Because somebody sitting out there listening was willing to step in the gap, lovingly disciple, and because Apollos was teachable, to be transformed. So what does that mean for you and for me? Where do we go with this? First thing I want us to understand is that we really do need and need you to understand that you're called to the ministry. You're called to actively participate, not just to fill a box. No, you're as you follow Jesus, you're called to follow him into ministry. Whatever it is that Jesus, that you see Jesus is doing, you jump into that. You follow him in that. You participate in that. You don't shrink back. It's not somebody else's job. No, God has placed you here now for this very reason. The question is, will we do that? Will we step into the gap? Will we step into the opening? Will we allow God's Spirit to flow through us and change the world around us? Because that's the invitation. So let's bow our heads. And let me just, as our heads are bowed, give you these three next steps. What do I do with what I just heard? First thing I challenge you with is if you're here, if you're watching online and you've never said yes to Jesus, you've never said, I want to become a follower of Jesus, I want to give my whole life, I want to pour my whole life into this thing, then today's a great day to do that. I would encourage you to take that step. Second thing I would challenge you with is this, that this week I will celebrate the wonders God has done in my life. We talked about how the genesis of the Palm Sunday celebration was they had seen these wonders, these miracles that God had done, the things he had said through Jesus, and it elicited this celebratory spirit, this celebration of an exaltation of the King. I challenge you this week to take some time and remember those things in your own life, the miracles that God has done, the wonders that God has performed in you and around you. Third thing is this. This week, I will use the gifts God has placed in me for the good of those around me. Apollos desperately needed Priscilla and Aquila to step in because they were willing to take those things that God had deposited in them and use them. It changed and transformed Apollo's life. So, Father, I pray, Lord, for my brothers and sisters in this room, Lord, I pray that you would help us to, Lord, to see the opportunities that we have in the life of those around us to help each other live left foot, right foot, left foot, right foot, consistently following hard after you. And Lord, I pray that you would help us, every one of us, towards that end. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 So what we want to do now is to prepare to receive an offering. And so we have some folks that will come up, and then they'll walk through the room. So if you guys want to go ahead and move into position, that'd be great. Father, I thank you this morning for your blessings towards us, your grace and your mercy. God, I pray that you would help us to, Lord, just as I was just saying, just celebrate the activity of God around us and in us. Lord, I pray now that you would bless this offering, that you would use it for the glory of your name. God, that your name would be made famous in our church, in our community, and in our world. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Amen. So if you have your Connect card or offering, you can just sort of wave these guys down. I know many people participate in many different ways. If you're watching online, you can also participate. You can go to CobbVineyard.com, click on the donate button. You can write a check, send it snail mail. You can go to your financial institution and set up a bill pay, and they'll send it out for you, and that would be a great thing. And as I say, thank you for your faithfulness and consistency in doing that as well. So we're going to have the worship team lead us in a song, and then we're going to have an opportunity to receive prayer. And so why don't we all stand? We'll do that. We come before you now, Lord, and we come acknowledging, God, that we're a people who are in great need. Lord, we are in great need of your presence in our life. We're in great need of your power, Lord, released in our life. We're in great need of your healing power, God. We're in great need of your restoring power, Jesus. Lord, we are in great need of you. And so, Father, we ask in Jesus' name, I ask that you would move among us in power this morning. Lord, I ask in the mighty name of Jesus, the strong Son of God, Lord, that you would restore bodies in this place today. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would bring complete and total healing to bones and vertebrae and ligaments, and Lord, that there would be complete and total restoration. God, I pray in the name of Jesus that there would be healing, Lord, of emotional wounds and things that have caused us to emotionally and relationally walk with a limp. God, that you would deliver us and set us free and bring healing and wholeness, Lord, into our psyches and into our emotions, God. That you would give us clarity, Lord, that we would not lash out of hurt, but that you would deliver us, Lord, that you would set us free from the scars of those wounds. And Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would anoint my fellow ministers in this room, Lord, that we would together see the kingdom of God come in power. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So I want to ask you to do something. I want to ask everybody to have a seat. And What I'm going to ask, I don't want anybody to do anything initially, okay, because I know some of you are in pain. But I want to ask for, if you're here and you are physically in pain, okay? And you say, what does that mean? If you're in pain, you know what it means, okay? But I just want to say, if you're physically in pain, in a few minutes, I'm gonna ask you just to stand right by your chair. Because you've got lots of ministers all around you that want to lay hands and pray for you. Okay? So one is, if you're physically in pain, I believe that Jesus wants to come and heal your body. Okay? Also, if you're here and you are, I don't know how to describe it other than, emotionally, you can tell that you are, and relationally, that you're responding out of woundedness rather than out of a healthy place. Okay? And again, if you're not sure what I'm talking about, ask the person sitting next to you. Okay? They can probably help you understand that. But I believe that Jesus wants to come and touch you there. Begin to that process of restorative healing power. Thank you, Lord. I also believe that there are people that are here that you're carrying a weight that is weighing you down. I mean, it's almost as if physically you're hunched over because of the weight that you're trying to bear up under, and you need Jesus to come and to lift that burden from you, to give you grace that you could cast your cares on Him, knowing that He cares for you. Okay, so I know some of you may be in pain to the point that it's uncomfortable to stand, and I get that. So if that's your case, but you say, I need prayer, raising your hand is okay as well. But if you can stand, I'd encourage you to do that. So let me just invite you, if you need to receive prayer, just stand or raise your hand right by where you are, and don't think, well, it's not that bad. Okay, if you're in pain, if you can stand, stand. Okay? Keep standing. Thank you, Lord. Okay? Anyone else? What I want to invite you to do is, if you're sitting, you are commissioned as the ministry team. Okay? You've been blessed. So I want to invite you to move to these people that are standing. And I would say we need to have at least 3 or 4 people with each person that's standing. And let me ask something else. If you're with the person that you're standing beside, or no, if you're with the person that is standing, go pray for somebody else. And let somebody pray for you. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay. That means that when I say go, everybody should get out of their seat and move somewhere. Okay? Everybody understand that part? And if you say, well, I can't do that, you should already be standing. See how that works? Okay. So 1, 2, 3, go find somebody to pray for and pray and ask Jesus to come and do a healing. And in just a moment, I'm going to ask if you're standing and nobody has come to pray for you yet to let me know. Okay? Okay, is there anybody standing that they don't have somebody over praying for them yet? Anybody? Raise your hand up so that I can see it. I'll make sure people get there. Okay. Awesome. Pray and ask the kingdom of God to come. Let the glory of Jesus come. Let the healing power of the kingdom of God, let it come. Let the greatness of God come. Let the restoring power of Jesus come. In the name of Jesus, come. Come, Lord. Come, Lord. Come, Lord. Come, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Come, Lord. Let your healing power come, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. So I know many are still praying. If you are finished praying, let me just ask, is there anyone that you were just prayed for that you feel like God touched you? I mean, that you feel better than you did before they prayed? If so, just lift your hand. Anybody? Not yet? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. More, Lord. More, Lord. More, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You know, once you're finished praying, if you want to make your way back to your seats, I promise I'm only going to keep you about another minute and a half. Not sure how long God's going to keep you, but so let me just ask again, because I know several of you. Anybody that received prayer that feels appreciably better than they did before they got prayed for? If you'll just let me know. Anybody? Father, I just thank you for these incredible ministers of God that we get to join with week after week. Lord, I pray that you would commission us, that you would anoint us, and that you would use us for the glory of your name. Lord, in this season when it seems that hearts are stirred and open and ripe for the harvest, Lord, I pray that you would send laborers. And Lord, that you would even allow us to be part of that number. And I thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for your goodness towards us, your mercy and your grace. And I thank you for all of these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. 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 There's a few folks that are still praying, so we'll let them finish. But everybody else, God bless you. Thanks for being here. Hope to see you Friday night, 7 o'clock, for a Good Friday service. God bless you.